The Legend of the Third Dove by Stefan Zweig. In the book of Genesis, there is written the story of the first dove, and also of the second, which the patriarch Noah sent forth out of the ark, when the windows of heaven were stopped and the waters of the deep abated. Yet who has told of the travels and the destiny of the third dove? The ship of salvation, carrying within it all life that was spared from the flood, had grounded upon the peak of Mount Ararat. But the patriarch, from his masthead, could see naught save the rise and fall of an infinity of water. He therefore sent out a dove, the first dove, to bring him news of any land that might be seen beneath the lowering skies. The first dove, so we are told, soared upwards and spread her wings. She flew to the east and to the west, but the waters were everywhere. She found no rest for the sole of her foot, and gradually her wings began to weaken. So she returned to the one firm place on earth, to the ark, and she fluttered about the ship, which rested on the mountain peak, until Noah put forth his hand, and took her, and pulled her in unto him into the ark. Now he waited for 7 days. 7 days in which no rain fell, and the waters sank. Then he took another dove, the second, and sent her out to search. The dove flew out in the morning, and when she returned at the eventide, she bore in her bill an olive leaf, the first sign that the earth was uncovered once again. Thus Noah learned that the treetops were already clear of the water, and that the trial was surmounted. After another 7 days, he once again sent forth a dove, the third, and she flew out into the world. In the morning she set forth, yet by evening she had not returned, and though Noah awaited her day after day, she never came back. Thus our ancestor knew that the earth was free and the waters sunken away. But of that dove, the third dove, he never heard again, nor did mankind either, for her legend has not been revealed until today. These were the travels and the destiny of the third dove. In the morning, she had flown forth from the ship's musty hold, where the beasts, crowded in darkness, stirred impatiently, hoof to claw, amidst a confusion of roaring and whistling, hissing and lowing. From confinement she flew forth into the infinity of space, from darkness into light. And when she spread her wings in the clean, clean air washed sweet by the rain, she felt at once the freedom that was all about her and the grace of boundlessness. The waters of the deep glistened. The forests shone green as dewy moss. The mists of dawn drifted white across the meadows, and those meadows were sweetly scented by the opening blossoms. Brightness poured down from the metallic sky to be mirrored below, so that the rising sun was reflected in a pink, eternal dawn. Upon the rocky mountaintops, while the sea shone blood red and the flowering earth, too, steamed warm as blood. It was godlike to watch this awakening, and in an ecstasy of vision, the dove floated across the purple world. Easily she flew over lands and seas, and in her dream slowly became herself a gliding dream. Like God himself, she was now the first to see the earth set free, and there was no end to her looking. She had long ago forgotten Noah, the white-bearded captain of the ark. She had forgotten her mission. She had forgotten that she must return, for the world was now her home, the heavens her very own house. And so the third dove, the patriarch's faithless messenger, flew across the empty world, on and ever onwards, borne up by the violence of her joy, by the wind of her blissful unrest, ever onwards, until her pinions grew heavy and her feathers leaden. The earth drew her down towards itself with a mighty force. Her tired wings sank lower and lower, so that already they grazed the damp treetops. And at last, on the evening of the second day, she settled down in the midst of a wood, which, like everything else at time's beginning, was without a name. She hid deep in a thicket and rested from her journey through the skies. The twigs sheltered her, the breeze lulled her, the wood was cool by day, and a warm dwelling place by night. She soon forgot the windy heavens and the call of far places. Embowered in the green trees, time grew over her, unreckoned. It was a wood of the world close to us that the last dove had chosen for her home. But there were as yet no human beings within it, and in this solitude she gradually became a dream unto herself. In the darkness, in the green shade she nestled, and the years passed her by, and death forgot her. For of all those beasts, two of each breed which had seen the first world before the flood, none can ever die nor be harmed by the hunter. Invisible, they shelter in the hidden folds of earth's garment. And even so did this dove live deep in the forest. Sometimes, it is true, forebodings of the presence of man would reach her. A shot would ring out and be re-echoed 100-fold from the walls of green. Axes would be driven into the trunks so that the encircling darkness groaned. The soft laughter of lovers as they stole away together was a murmur in the undergrowth. And the songs of children picking berries came thinly from afar. The lost dove, enmeshed in foliage and in dream, sometimes heard those worldly voices, but they caused her no fear, and she remained in her darkness. But one day the whole wood began to roar and crack as though the very world were falling apart. Black masses of metal screamed through the air, and where they fell, the earth leapt up in horror, and the trees were snapped like grasses. Men in colored clothes hurled death at one another, and fearful machines spewed forth fire and flame. Lightning shot up from earth to clouds, and after it thunder. It was as though the land wished to jump into the sky, or the sky to fall upon the land. The dove awakened from her dream. Death was all about her, and destruction. As once the water, so now fire was spread across the world. Quickly, she stretched her wings and fluttered upwards, in search of a new home to replace her crashing, crackling wood, in search of a place where there was peace. She fluttered upwards and flew across our world in search of peace, but go where she would, she found everywhere the same man-made lightning, the same man-made thunder. Everywhere was war. A sea of fire and blood had once again engulfed the earth. Another flood had come, and quickly she flew across the land, searching for a place of rest whence she might return to the patriarch, bearing the olive leaf of promise in her bill. But in these days none was to be found. Ever higher rose the tide of ruin over mankind, while the flames raced ever on across the face of our world. She has not yet found a resting place, nor humanity peace. And until then she may not return home. She may not be forever still. No man has seen her, the lost and mythical dove in her search for peace. But still she flutters over our heads, frightened and with pinions that are already weary. Sometimes, deep in the night, a man awakening from a startled sleep may hear wings beating high up in the air, haste in darkness, anguished, unheeding flight. Upon her is the weight of all our somber thoughts. In her fear are carried all our wishes, and there, fluttering between heaven and earth, is the lost dove. It is our own destiny that she now must learn, that she now must bear back. That faithless messenger of long ago, to the patriarch of mankind. And once again, as those thousands of years ago, the world is waiting, waiting that a hand be put forth to take her, waiting for the knowledge that the trial has been at last enough.